Well, good afternoon, everyone. This is Waite Hoyt speaking to you on behalf of Claude Sullivan, myself, and the Burger Brewing Company.
Back in those days, they had the Boston Braves, and it was the Spawn and Sane and Pray for Rain. Well, we didn't have Spawn and Sane. We just prayed for rain. Because when it rained, we had Waite.
We want to hear a good story. One day, the president of the Burke Brewing Company, for whom I broadcast, called me at home, and he said, "Waite," he said, "this afternoon, this morning, he said, will you stop down to the office?" The office then was in the First National Bank building. And I said, "Oh, yes, Mr. Coon, certainly." And then I stopped in, and he said, "I just wanted to read you a letter," he said, "that I received," he said, "and in the past couple of days, he thought you'd be interested in it." He said, "It isn't a very complimentary letter, but," he said, "I'm sure that you're used to booing from the stands and things of that kind." He said, "But may I read it to you?" And I said, "Why, sure, go right ahead." So it said, the fellow didn't know Jack Coon's name, so he said, "The president of the Burger Brewing Company, dear sir," he said, "I am writing to you to complain about that broadcaster of yours." He says, "He is the worst broadcaster in the United States. He says he can't get anything right. He's a bum. He's lousy." And then he got by the pleasant adjectives and got down to the real ones. Then I was all kinds of an SOB and everything else he could think of, and all the language was obscene and almost pornographic, and it was terrible. And I had he just ripped me apart. And why, I'll never listen to another broadcast unless you get rid of that guy. He stinks, and the orgy was awful. And I had to sit there and listen to about a whole page of this. And in the very last paragraph, it said, and I said, "For that burger beer," he says, "you must be running a horse ranch." And then he said, "I wouldn't drink that slop," he said, "if you paid me." He said, "It's the lousiest beer." And then Jack Coon turned to me and he said, "Can you imagine anybody saying those kind of things about burger beer?"
Waite was born to Addison and Louise Hoyt on September 9, 1899, in New York. He always liked to refer to the fact, "I was born 9999. That's good luck for people who are born such as 8888 or 4444, that sort of thing.
Waite Hoyt's father, Addison, was a vaudevillian. Ad Hoyt's minstrels played New York City, and kid actor Waite often was in the show. Louise Hoyt was a freelance writer and full-time mother.
He was probably a little more educated than other players of the era. His parents were educated people. Even though he was signed out of high school, he always kept up an interest in current affairs. He read a lot.
For Waite, it was a comfortable middle-class but short childhood. The spotlight of actor and sports star at Erasmus High School in Brooklyn brought the professionals to this superb athlete as a young teen.
Schoolboy, as the nickname, was a media tag, and that's because Hoyt was signed at the age of 15 out of Erasmus High School in Brooklyn. And at 15 years old, he was 31-2, had pitched 6 no-hitters, already had a major league fastball, so John McGraw, the Giants, signed him. At the time, Waite Hoyt was the youngest player ever signed, and that was the case until another fellow came along by the name of Joe Nuxhall, who was signed at the age of 14, and then the two wound up as broadcasters for the Reds.
He would kid me and back and forth. I told him I threw harder when I was 15 than he did when he was 30. And he said, "Yeah, but you didn't know where home plate was." And we had a lot of fun jockeying back and forth.
Waite was still a minor in the eyes of the law, so Father Addison had to sign the contract with the New York Giants. Rumor has it, Dad also took the $5 bonus, but Waite took off for the minors, although he had to drop out of high school to do so.
His English teacher was very very disappointed in that because she saw a career in writing for Waite.
In 1918, Waite Hoyt was promoted to the New York Giants. The 18-year-old pitched one scoreless inning, struck out two, and a 20-year career had begun in his native city where he would rise to fame and fortune, but not for the New York Giants or in the National League.
Boston Red Sox sent a scout around to look me over and had me report to Washington and pitch batting practice. They liked what they saw, and they asked me to come to Boston, which I did, and I signed a contract with the Boston Red Sox.
At age 19, Hoyt won his first big league game, July 31st, 1919, a 2-1, 12-inning complete game win over the Detroit Tigers. A Boston outfielder named Babe Ruth supplied the offense, four hits and both RBIs. During his two seasons with the Red Sox, 1919 and 1920, Hoyt won 10 and lost 12. Then in the biggest win of his career, Hoyt was traded by the Red Sox to the same place Ruth had been dealt a year earlier, the New York Yankees. And so the golden years that would pave Hoyt's road to the Hall of Fame would take place in his native New York City with the Bronx Bombers of Ruth and Gehrig.
We had a fellow sent to us from Boston by the name of Jumping Joe Dugan. Now, Dugan was my roommate for years after we joined the Yankees. Now, Dugan, of course, was our holy cross. And it seems that years ago, Joe Dugan played shortstop for Holy Cross. And Connie Mack of the Philadelphia Athletics have heard about this skinny Irishman up there at the cross who was destined to become a great shortstop or a great infielder on any particular time in the future. So Connie Mack dispatched Ira Thomas, a scout, to Holy Cross and to look this young Irishman over. And sure enough, Ira Thomas liked what he saw, and he saw Dugan performing at shortstop, and Thomas was empowered to offer Dugan $500 if he liked him. So he nailed Dugan after this ball game. I don't know really, probably playing Boston College up there. Anyway, Ira Thomas said, Joe, he said, would you like to play professional baseball? And Dugan said, yeah, sure we'd like to play professional baseball. He said, would you join the Philadelphia Athletics? And Joe said, that I'd have to think about. So, at any rate, out came the $500, $500 bills, and Thomas fanned them out like that, so he's got $500. He said, would you join him for $500? And Dugan says, you can have the whole family for $500. Now, this guy, Dugan, is one of the wittiest Irishmen I've ever seen, you know. So they joined the Philadelphia Athletics, and they put him in the first day right away, because Connie used to have three teams. One going, one on the field, and one coming, see? So they put Dugan right in at shortstop, and Dugan used to choke the bat. He's up there hitting, and he doesn't recognize who the pitcher is, but it's Big Waller Johnson. And Johnson's out on the side with a fastball over there, so Dugan looked at 12 strikes. And as Dugan is standing there, he goes like this, and the ball's going by him, so after the 12th straight strike, Dugan turned around and said to the umpire, geez, you might make him throw the ball.
In 1921, the first of nine glorious years with the Yankees. The team would win its first of a dynasty of pennants, but Hoyt's 20-win season is lost to a publicity stunt by Ruth and the Yankee management.
The first time I had a chance to win 20 games in the big league, I started as sort of a practice affair in the next to last game of the season because we had already won the pennant then, and I was ahead 7-0 in the seventh inning and apparently had my 20th game won. And Ruth, Babe Ruth, who had been a pitcher years before, hadn't pitched a game all year, and by George, the fans wanted to see Ruth pitch, so as a novelty gesture, Miller Huggins called Ruth in from the outfield and had Ruth finish the game as a pitcher, and by George, if the Athletics don't tie the score 7-7, and then Ruth in the ninth inning hit another home run and won the game 8-7 again, and by George, they don't give him the credit for winning the ball game. After I'm ahead 7-0 and retired from the game just as a novelty idea to let the fans take a peek at Ruth pitch, and that was my 20th win.
He wouldn't win that elusive 20th for another five seasons, though he remains the ace of baseball's most consistent and powerful winner. In 1923, he won 17 games as the Yankees won their first world title. In 1926, he records 16 wins for a pennant winner, but he lost Game 7 to the St. Louis Cardinals in the World Series. At age 27, Hoyt still had not won 20 games. And while he had a world championship in 23, he had lost three others. During spring training 1927, Hoyt took what he described as his first personal inventory.
I pitched the last game of the 1926 World Series, and we lost it. And that winter, I got to thinking, I fell to thinking about this whole thing, and I thought, Waite, you've been a dunce all these years, and you haven't listened. You've been hard-headed, you've been egotistical, you've been all the things that a man shouldn't be, and perhaps you better listen to somebody else once in a while. So we were training in St. Petersburg, Florida, and I don't know how many of you folks have been in St. Petersburg, Florida, but nevertheless, there's a stone pier, that concrete pier that juts out into the bay, oh, perhaps a quarter of a mile. And alongside of this pier, at night, the boats are moored, and there was this one particularly lovely evening with the moon shining and the stars and the were brilliant in the sky. And it was just a perfect, the kind of a night that the Florida Chamber of Commerce likes to brag about. And it was certainly that. And I walked out there alone. Now, I wasn't in the habit of being alone a great deal. I mean, I was always seeking company and somebody to have a little fun with. And I was fairly successful in that realm. And But this particular night, I wandered out there by myself, and there was the railings along the side were those iron pipe railings, and I remember leaning on putting my elbows on the top of that railing and looking down, and I stood there by myself thinking about myself, thinking very, very desperately about myself and very deeply. And I think that's the first personal inventory that I ever took of myself. And I began to feel as if I was in the midst of a great infinity, and I guess that I was. And I swear to goodness, it was just as if some human or some physical being touched me on the shoulder. I felt the presence of a greater power. And I stood there by myself thinking, Wait, what a simple ass you are to think that you believe that you knew so much and you don't know anything at all. And the people have tried to tell you, and people have lectured you, Huggins has lectured you, everybody has talked to you, and you've turned a deaf ear to everybody. Isn't it about time that you listen? And aren't you just a very, very minute part of the universe and of this world? And aren't you just something small and insignificant when it comes down to the relationships of other people? And as I stood there thinking about those things, I determined that I would go to Miller Huggins and tell him about it. And as I left that pier, to tell you the truth, I had formed a catechism of pitching, and in short, certain rules to follow in pitching, which had been told me, which I had never observed too much in my life, preferring to go my own way. And the next day I went to Miller Huggins, and I said, Miller, the things that you've been trying to tell me for years, I have learned by myself last night, reviewing everything that has been told me. And I left that pier, and with a different fellow than when I walked out there. And Miller Huggins said to me, Waite, he said, I was wondering if you would ever come to me and admit what you just have, and that you would take yourself seriously and get down to business. He said, you know, he said, he used to tell me things like this, you won't lead the league until you pitch here instead of here. You won't lead the league in pitching until you stop looking in the grandstand to see how your friends are doing. You won't lead, and he'd go through this whole list of things, all these faults. Well, I finally determined that I would do certain things when I went to the pitcher's mound. And by George, with the help of Miller Huggins, the help of God, my own personal observations of myself, I led the league the next 2 years. And to me, that was the greatest victories. That was a man's victory over man, or a man's victory over self, I believe.
The rededicated Hoyt became the winningest pitcher of the greatest team of all time, the 27 Yankees. Ruth hit 60 homers. Gehrig hit 47. Hoyt was 22-7, won the World Series opener against the Pirates to start the Yankee sweep. Finally, he was a 20-game winner on baseball's most famous team. He was also a world champ and one of the most feared pitchers in the league.
I was pretty young, you know, and I just thought he overpowered them. And I knew that he had good control. He told me that the only place, his father was in the vaudeville business, and the only place he could practice was in the narrow alleys behind the theater, and there wasn't any room to make any mistakes.
Overpowering because of his demeanor on the mound, he was one of these 1920s battling pitchers who wouldn't hesitate to knock you on your fanny if you crowded the plate.
Like he would tell me, he says, Jim, you know, when you're out there, you can't show any sign of weaknesses. You know, we always went nine, so, you know, I tried to go nine every time I went out there, which you don't hear of anymore. And Waite Hoyt is, he said, if you wipe your brow or, you know, look like you're tired out there, that means, you know, that your opponents are going to think you're weakening, you know, but you can never show any kind of emotion. You've got to be stern, focused, and go at them.
Hoyt followed in 28 with 23 wins and 7 losses, his second and last 20-win season. In the World Series against the St. Louis Cardinals, Hoyt won the opener and the Game 4 clincher. He was the ace, the money man of the staff, and outside of Ruth, the toast of the Big Apple, and he was living life in the fast lane.
Waite, said, would you like to come to a party tomorrow night? He said, up in the Arlington roof. And he said, you and Joe, he said, now it's a black tie affair. Now the Arlington roof was one of the very swank nightclub spots in Washington. Buck, he said, gee, this is going to be something. You're going to be people from the French embassy, the Dutch embassy, all the embassy. There'll be a very international affair. So I said, gee, this is right up our alley. This is going to be fun. So all right, around and now the night comes, around Dugan and I go up on the Arlington roof, and it was just as Bucky Harris promised. Gee, what delightful looking people, the elite of Washington, from all the embassies and the dignitaries and the very, very polished. And we had a lovely time. But now it came time for dinner, and they sat us all down. We were seated around this one round table. There's about 12 of us. And Bucky Harris, the Washington manager, is on the other side of the table. His wife is next to him, and around we come. And seated between Dugan and myself is this French babe. Ha ha! Gee! You should have seen Dugan. I never knew they operated that way at Holy Cross. I didn't think that type of biological study was incorporated in the curriculum up at the Cross. So Joe was giving this to once over because this babe really had it, and she brought it all with her. And there it was, you see. And now I've got to pitch the next day, and I watched Dugan. And Dugan is giving it all. Gee, he's really turning it on. You never saw such a workman in your life. So I reached around his French babe, and I hit him a punch in the middle of the back, and I said, for God's sake, cut it out. And he said, what are you talking about? And I said, that drinking, Jesus. I said, well, I'm working tomorrow. And I said, I want a third baseman who can stand up. So he said, he looks over at Bucky Harris, and he says to Bucky, say, who are you pitching tomorrow, Bucky? And Bucky says, Courtney. Well, Courtney was a left-hander that Dugan used to hit about 600 against. So Dugan says, fill him up again. So, the next day we get out there, it's not Courtney at all. It's Big Waller again. And we're doing pretty well. We get down about the sixth inning, and the score's around nothing to nothing. I forget exactly what it was. And suddenly Washington loaded the bases, you see. Now I'm in a jam, a real jam. Well, I must explain to you fellas that in those days, you see, they didn't have the type of meetings that they have in the pitcher's box today. You know, today they come in, you know, you see the manager, he trots on and says, is there anything wrong with you? And the guy says, I feel a twinge. Take a month off, don't exert yourself, but be sure to go up and get your $50,000 check, and he said, lay off a lot. But in those days, you know, they'd come into the pitcher's box and they'd say,
Well, you so-and-so, you got yourself in it, get yourself out of it. Now, Dugan comes over from third base, and Dugan is giving it the quanti swat, you know, that punch bit. And I said, geez, I know you didn't learn how to Holy Cross. I said, where did you learn the French? Ha ha, says he, off a cologne bottle last night.
With the conclusion of 1928, so ended the bright part of Hoyt's pitching career. He still had 10 years to go, but had already won two-thirds of his career games. During those nine Yankee seasons, he had rung up 157 wins and only 98 losses. He was traded to the Detroit Tigers in 1930 and pitched for six other teams through 1938, winning 80 more games. In 1938, he was 0-3 with a 4.96 earned run average when the end came in his native Brooklyn. The Dodgers released him.
He came to the ballpark like normal day, got into the locker room, and there was a telegram on the bench in front of his locker, which of course was his unconditional release. So he went home. That was it. He knew that was the end. He said that he stood outside of Ebbets Field and looked up at it, and absolutely sobbed. He was so broken up to know that that was the end of his baseball career, that his professional, big league career. And so he went home, and it was evidently a beautiful, beautiful May day. And he broke the news to Ellen, and she said, "Well, it's a beautiful day to get your unconditional release." He said, "I could have killed her." And then he said, "I thought, yes, it is a beautiful day."
His pitching career was over, but baseball would remain the central force of his life, and Cincinnati was about to become his home.
Babe Ruth went through life without ever using names, probably because it didn't matter to him. Everyone was Keith, or he had some other pet nicknames. And the story that Waite told was about the time he, Waite, was traded from the New York Yankees. And he was sitting in the clubhouse and, you know, very dejected. And Ruth came by and said, "So long, Walter, good luck." Well, you know.
And he said another thing he described about old-time ballplayers, he said, was there were no night games in those days. So what happened was, you went to the ball game in the afternoon, and you sat around on the dugout, and you talked about women during the baseball game. And then you went out at night with women, and you talked about baseball.
Teamwork is fine when you don't have the great individuals. When I ought to have nine Ty Cobbs not speaking to each other than I would a flock of 260 hitters who slept with each other.
Although the Brooklyn Dodgers released Hoyt, his 20-year big league career and appearing in seven different World Series had catapulted him into one of the big names of the Big Apple. His first broadcast job was in Manhattan at WMCA. The show was 3 hours, not sports, but a variety show called Grandstand and Bandstand. In 1941, he was hired by WOR Radio for pre- and post-game features and commentary on the Brooklyn Dodgers network.
He had a hard time getting into the press box just because of the fact that he was a player. Because at that time, they thought that players were just not articulate or that sort of thing.
Waite was the first of the, was the first ex-athlete to make it big in the broadcast booth. When Waite came along in the 1930s, late 1930s is when he was trying to break into the business. At that time, the sports announcing profession was in its infancy. It was not highly respected. When Waite was auditioning and when he was looking for that broadcast job, he had to fight against the stereotype that ex-athletes were either dumb or they weren't very interesting or they weren't well-spoken.
In the off-season of 1942, Hoyt signed with the William Morris Agency, then, as now, a powerhouse talent agency placing prominent personalities with available jobs. The call came from WKRC Radio and Burger Beer in Cincinnati.
When he took the job, I think he took it with the intention that he was going to get some experience here and then would go back to New York once he was a proven sportscaster.
And we were glad to have him here. That was big stuff for Cincinnati.
And so in 1942, Waite Hoyt was hired by WKRC Radio and Burger Beer as the voice of the Reds, but not exclusively, not even first.
He was on one station. We had the games on two other stations. Harry Hartman, I think, was doing them, and I forget who was doing them on the other station, but he was the third man in town. He was a new man, but it wasn't long that he was the third man. He came right to the top.
I started keeping score when I was a kid of the Reds games and listening to Waite. And I wanted to know about Honus Wagner, and I wanted to know about Babe Ruth and all these great people. And of course, baseball cards were the thing that were in at that time. One of the baseball cards I had was Babe Ruth, and the other one was Schoolboy Hoyt.
While his on-air work and professional life proceeded smoothly, his private life and dark relationship with alcohol dealt a near fatal jolt to his broadcast career in 1945 when he disappeared for 3 days.
When we would go on the road, when we were traveling, you see, we used to go away a month at a time, not like these fellows. They have to return to Mama quick in 3 days. But we'd be away a month practically. And the Yankees always got Babe a suite of rooms. You see, a living room, big living room, and a bedroom, and one thing another. And Babe used to think it was because he was Babe Ruth, the big star that they got for him, you see. But that wasn't it at all. They knew if they got him this suite of rooms that he'd stay in it. So as a consequence, they always knew where he was. Now, he had a red silk bathrobe, and he had red Moroccan slippers. He'd tell the bellboys and tip them. At a certain time, they'd bring the ice up, cracked ice, because those days didn't have refrigerators with ice trays. And they would load the bathtubs with ice and fill it with beer and champagne. And then Babe would entertain like the king, you know, and he'd sit back there, and the people would come in, the doors would be open. But there would be one, I'm not fooling you now, there'd be anywhere from 25 to 100 to 150 people pass through the suite of rooms at night. And he would sit there, and he would just entertain, and he held court, is what he actually did. And I can't imagine other people doing these kind of things. And then all the Protestants in Chicago would go to church with Babe on Sunday, because he's a Catholic, and the church wasn't too far away from where we stayed in Chicago. And why did we go? Because Babe would always put a $50 bill in the plate, and paying for all the sins that he had accumulated.
Waite Hoyt had become a familiar name to Cincinnati Reds fans. After 3 seasons, he was not yet an institution, but a play-by-play man with talent and an eloquent vocabulary for description. But his disposition would change when he was drinking. So on Tuesday, June 19th, 1945, in a hotel on 4th Street, the longest journey in the life of Waite Hoyt would begin.
The Sinton Hotel was at 4th and Vine Street in Cincinnati, and it was a long-time Cincinnati institution.
Hoyt and Lee Allen had been invited to the Sinton Hotel that June afternoon, 1945, by the president of a jewelry company for the purpose of giving both Hoyt and Allen a wristwatch.
And we had martinis for lunch, and don't forget I had a broadcast that afternoon. But I never made it. But Lee Allen and myself wound up in the Sinton bar drinking double martinis, and which were very, very potent and very, very nice. But they were rather unkind to me, because that's when I went on the amnesia binge.
The amnesia binge was Hoyt's 3-day drunken bender, during which he bottomed out after one final shot of some horrid rot gut whiskey.
You know, I often think of that, because if it had been a good drink, I may not have quit. But I had disappeared from home for 3 days. I really had. I disappeared from home for 3 days. I was a high-class alcoholic, if you don't mind. I didn't find the joints. I was had a suite at the Netherlands Plaza Hotel for 3 days. I don't know why anybody couldn't find me. I was right there. But I used to saunter around at night and look for new ways of taking a drink, you see. And I could, if a mouse ran across the floor, that was a new way to take another drink. But I will never forget the final day, because I knew that I suspected that they were looking for me, I wound up at the, to see if I'm right in this, I wound up at the end of Reading Road and Broadway.
And that was a joint, you know, and that was a good place for him to get rolled and taken and everything else.
And I tell you, there was the lousiest dump of a saloon that I had ever seen. But my hands were shaking like that, and I had to hold on to the glass to get it up to my mouth. And I remember going in this place and asking for a drink. And I wasn't particular whether it was bar whiskey or good whiskey. But I finally got it up there. And this is truly one of the high emotional periods of my life. And I stood there drinking this thing, and the guy said, "What's the matter with you?" And I said, "Nothing." Jesus, nothing. And the guy must have been blind, because, you know, and at any rate, I got the glass up and the whiskey down, and I did feel a little better. And I went and stood on the curb of Reading Road and Broadway. And I suddenly thought to myself, now I'm going to ask your indulgence for just a moment, if you don't mind. And please don't believe that I'm being immodest. In my lifetime, I had acquired some type of notoriety, if you wish to put it that way. And I stood on the curb and said to myself, "Jesus, are you really going to let yourself go this way?" And I can remember that they're possibly the only sane thoughts or sober thoughts that I had had. The only serious thoughts that I had about myself. And I thought to myself, "Wait, for God's sake, don't do it." And I started to cry. And I stood there and cried for a long while. And then I called up Good Sam Hospital and got a hold of Sister Andrew. Mm-hmm. And she said, "Take a cab, we're waiting for you." And which I did. And that was the last drink I ever had.
That was on Thursday, June 21st, 1945, 3 days since the double martini luncheon at the Sinton Hotel, which had triggered the drinking binge. Hoyt was due to broadcast the game that night at Crosley Field between the Reds and St. Louis Cardinals. It was his third straight miss at the microphone, but there was a fill-in voice.
It was Lee Allen. And, you know, it's a stroke of luck if you find Lee sober.
Waite's wife, Ellen, had also filed a missing persons report with police. So when he ended up at Good Samaritan Hospital, there was some explaining to do to the community at large.
Well, I remember that he wasn't there, and then he wasn't there for several nights. Well, he could have been sick. I mean, nobody said anything. But then finally, the little squib came out in the paper that he was missing, that his wife had reported that he was missing. It was known in the city that he was a heavy drinker. I mean, that was no secret. That was known.
I think he was an ill man, but I don't think it was amnesia.
Did you believe the headline at the time?
No. No, I didn't.
Did anybody in town?
I don't think anybody did. Everybody laughed about it.
And this is the honest bound truth. I was in the hospital at the time, which I'll tell you about in a second. But I got a wire from Babe Ruth, because it said in the paper that Waite Hoyt was found and suffering from a bad case of amnesia. And I got a wire from Babe saying, "I hear you have a case of amnesia." He says, "That's a new one on me. What brand is it?" So I had a little joviality along with my demise.
But his hospital stay was no laughing matter. despite his life success, schoolboy phenom, Yankee ace, World Series hero, and radio star, at age 45, he considered suicide.
Now, you must remember that this is all founded on the idea that I, in a deep depression, and absolute quitting on myself, and quitting on the world, quitting on my friends, my relatives, and everybody else in the world, and ready to take almost a deep plunge off the world.
I was in Good Sam Hospital, and suddenly one day a man appeared, and he very quiet, very unobtrusive, very gently, and very appealing. And he stood at the foot of my bed, and he said, I hear you're having a problem. And I said, yes, I guess I am. He said, lots of us have problems. And I said, the same kind? And he said, yes, the same kind. He said, I've heard of you. And I said, I said, just what did you hear? Well, he says, I've heard both sides of the story. And he said, he didn't say very much. He said, you know, there are ways of being helped and restoring yourself to mental balance. And I thought to myself, I'm not crazy yet. And when he mentioned the mental balance bit, and he didn't say much more. He said, I'm going to ask a favor of you. He was going to ask a favor of me. And I said, yes, sir, what is it? And he said, do you mind if I call on you occasionally, perhaps two or three times a week, and talk this over with you? And he said, you wouldn't mind if one of the sisters came in and talked to you either, would you? And I said, well, you see, I'm not too well acquainted with that interdenominational rigmarole. And I said, to tell you the truth, I'm a Protestant and an Episcopalian, and I don't know what a sister would be doing talking to me, or for that matter, me talking to her. So he said, well, I'm sure that you will enjoy her if she comes in. And I said, well, that's fine. And thereafter, that was the initial start of one of the greatest communions and friendships that I have ever known. And perhaps there started also, perhaps, the happiest part of my entire life. Also, Sister Andrew, who was only about 4 feet 11 tall, and who was a very wonderful, capable woman, and she used to take me out in the garden of Good Sam Hospital. The philosophy that she taught me and told me have stayed with me always. The manner in which she spoke to me, and she said, just what do you believe life is? And I said, I don't know, sister. I believe my life is over. I believe that when I was through with the game and with baseball, and I didn't feel myself as going any place. And as I said to her, sister, I believe my life is just about through, actually. And I see nothing ahead. I see no progress. I see nothing productive. I see no accomplishments, nothing that I can accomplish in life. And she said, why, Waite, she said, you're so mistaken. You're so mistaken. There's plenty for you to do in life. There's plenty that you can do for people and with people. She said, there's so much that you don't understand about life, and there's so much that you don't understand about character. She says, you should not judge yourself. You have been in conflict with yourself. There's one side of you that would like to quit. Is that right? And you've wanted to for a long while. And I said, sister, that is true. I wanted to quit drinking for so long. And I don't know how, and something just drives me onward and has compelled me. And she says, that's where the conflict enters, is right there. And she talked to me for hours on end, and I finally came around to, well, not her way of thinking exactly, but at least the doors opened. One door began to open, another door began to open. And that old bromide that we hear so often became an actual fact. As you begin to smell the roses, you begin to notice the goodness and the good things around you and the good things that are growing and the good things that attend you and the good things that happen to you, and you begin to notice also the wonderful characteristics in the people that you associate with.
While his rehabilitation was private, the public waited. Amnesia, the only explanation. Reds fans wondered if he would ever return to the play-by-play microphone.
We suddenly sounded like every other town. We sounded like, to take nothing away from any great sports announcers, and I don't mean to do that, but we sounded like Pittsburgh. We sounded like Chicago. We sounded like Boston.
I worried about him, and I wanted him back, and I wanted the community to take him back, and I wanted him to do well because I enjoyed him.
It took 68 days, but on August the 28th, 1945, noted by just a couple of lines in the Inquirer, Waite Hoyt was back at the microphone.
What was the reaction?
That was just about it. He's back. We're glad he's back. We knew he'd be back. There wasn't any big thing, people running around him sticking cameras in his face like they would today. It was just Waite was back, and he just picked it up. He didn't miss a beat. He didn't come on the air and say, I'm sorry, I was on a bender for 2 months, and then I went to dry out. He just did a ball game. He never, ever, 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 ever had such a problem again. I mean, the most remarkable thing about Waite is the endurance of his determination. Just stop. You know, that's what I meant when I said he had reproached himself before, and he was a man of high intellect, and he just said to himself, look here, this is stupid, and I ain't stupid, so that's the end of that.
In fact, for the remaining 39 years of his life, Waite Hoyt would never drink alcohol again. He became a major force in the Cincinnati Alcoholics Anonymous program. Still, in his professional life, he would pitch alcohol. It was his primary sponsor. His name became synonymous with Burger Beer.
He said, my job is to sell beer, but that doesn't mean I have to drink it. It means I can't drink it to keep my job, is the way he put it.
He was very straightforward about this. He said, I have absolutely nothing against alcohol, and I have absolutely nothing against drinking. He said, I am a drunk. He said, I cannot drink. He said, it is quite simple. He said, there are people who have that problem. There are other people who don't. He said, there are people who can sit down and enjoy a glass of beer, enjoy a glass of wine, enjoy a drink. And he says, I'm trying to remember, he used a phrase, he says, it's very useful as a social lubrication.
His job saved and sobriety in order, Waite Hoyt was still working on his family life. Ellen was his second wife. He had been married in 1924 to his high school sweetheart, Dorothy Pyle of Brooklyn. But after 7 years and two children, they were divorced in 1931.
In Waite's words, due to his fault, he was doing a lot of show business at that time, vaudeville, and he was pretty well carried away by the whole thing, and of course Dorothy stayed at home with the children.
Waite remained single until 1933 when he met Ellen Burbank.
And she came from a very high society family. They were in the shipping business. The Burbanks were their names. And they weren't, her family was not really thrilled with Waite's marriage to her or her marriage to him. And they never did have a very close relationship.
She met him on a ship. Waite was on his way to spring training that year. He saw her at a distance and thought she was a very good looking lady. And one evening he was down, I guess, in the where the dance floor was, and he saw her having somebody was trying to wanted to dance with her, and this person was not he could tell she didn't want to dance with this person. So being Waite, he jumped up and said, can't you see the lady doesn't want to dance with you? And he danced with her, and the rest is history.
They lived in Hyde Park and the Cincinnati Country Club. None of Waite's friends were ever allowed to come to any of her parties or anything at the house ever. It was a closed door as far as she was concerned. This was something she would not tolerate.
Why not?
Well, she just felt they were ruffians and tough. She told me a couple of times, I don't want to be with those guys.
The starting stumbling block was only the first of a myriad of tumult the marriage would endure. yet it would last 49 years, with their only son, Chris, born in 1939.
My mother didn't understand first base from home plate, okay, all right? And that was a complete mismatch. I mean, a total mismatch. The whole thing was a complete mismatch. She lived in a different world than he lived.
If mismatched at home, Waite Hoyt was a perfect fit behind the Reds' microphone. He became the sole voice of the Reds on WCPL radio. Berger Beer bought the exclusive rights in 1945. During his play-by-play run of the 40s, 50s, and 60s, the Reds bounced from WCPO radio to WSAI, back to WKRC, and then WCKY radio. But Berger Beer is Waite's employer, and Waite Hoyt becomes the voice of authority.
They'd get in an argument among themselves about certain players and what they, how they did things and all. And right away, somebody would say, well, Waite Hoyt said, and that settled the argument.
The Reds were a perennial second-division team in the 40s and much of the 50s. Reds fans developed a habit of inviting a break from the dreary season by enjoying the gloom of a rain-delay thunderstorm.
Back in those days, they had the Boston Braves, and it was a spawn and sane and pray for rain. Well, we didn't have spawn and sane. We just prayed for rain. Because when it rained, we had wait, you know. The rain delay literally was something one waited for. Certainly in my family, someone in the family, my Uncle George or my grandma or somebody would say, it's raining in Pittsburgh, and I would come running. I'd come running and sit down.
And it just occurred to me, believe it or not, that I played here myself, and I had forgotten all about it. I was here with the Athletics the second half of the season in 31 and pitched right here in the World Series. And got beaten, but right here in the World Series of 31, and I can remember coming here from Detroit. I was sent here from Detroit on waivers in 1931 and won six straight for this club, pitching for the Athletics in 31. But I wasn't in the best of condition. I can recall that. I was a little stout around the withers, and at any rate, I was against the Red Sox on the 4th of July afternoon. I recall that very easily. And Connie Mack had said, he said, I want you to give me six good innings. Can you give me six good innings? And I said, I think so. So he said, don't worry about the end of the game. He said, we have fellows that can take care of that, meaning like Lefty Grove or George Earnshaw. So luckily enough, we didn't need any help and got through the game very easily. And if Moran would be so kind as to ask what happened else in that game, well, I'd be very happy to answer him.
What happened?
I got three hits. Including a double. You see where it says Lee Tires out there in left center field?
That's a pretty good drive.
Boom, off that fence, and I tell you, that fence shook just like a missile hit it. In fact, the matter is that the ground crew ran out there. It took them 3 days to repair that wall.
On occasions, there'd be a group of us that sit around the table there in the middle of the clubhouse and listen to him expound on the Yankees and the Phillies and Philadelphia Athletics and so on down the line. And, it was interesting chatter.
I know people that didn't particularly like baseball, and if they saw it raining, they'd turn it on to listen to his story.
He made it feel like you were there. He made you want to listen and put your ear right to that radio and not miss a word. He was just that kind of a guy. He was contagious.
I was the one man in the clubhouse when Babe was fined the $5,000 because I was going to pitch that afternoon. And I had gone in there to change my shirt just prior to the leaving for the field to warm up. This is after batting practice. And Babe was late again. He came in late this particular day. Little Miller Huggins is in there. And it used to be a very remarkable thing the way that Babe and Hug would argue occasionally. They'd get in an altercation, and Miller Huggins would say, well, you're a disappointment to me, Babe. Why don't you go home? And Babe would say, why don't you send me home? And this would go on. Why don't you go home? Why don't you send me home? Why don't you go home? Why don't you send me home? But in St. Louis, it was real serious. And this day, Babe came in and he shucked his coat and he was going to hang it in the locker. And Miller Huggins standing there, little Miller, smoking on that little pipe as he used to puff away on it, you know. And Hug said, Babe, don't put on your uniform. Babe said, what do you mean don't put on a uniform? I said, I don't want you to put on the uniform, Babe. Babe said, why not?
He says, I've had enough of it, Babe. He says, you're fined and you're suspended. This is 1925. And Babe said, what do you mean I'm fined and suspended? You're fined $5,000, Babe, and you are suspended for the balance of the season. Babe got to crying like a big kid, and then Babe got on his feet, and he said he had never done anything like this before, and he had let the kids down, and he was going to be a better boy. Well, he was better as far as Babe could get better.
I help with the rain delay stories in this respect. When the rain would come along and the game would be interrupted, Waite would start talking about something, and then he would press the cough button, and he'd say, tell me something to talk about. And I'd just write down John McGraw, Connie Mack, Lefty Grove, never wrote Babe Ruth. I mean, he didn't have to. Joe Dugan, Comiskey Park, Jocko Conlon, anything like that, and then away he'd go.
No, I can't. It was kind of a subdued.
It was kind of a kind of that type of laugh, you know. But he laughed. I mean, I give old Waite credit. If you didn't think it was funny, he did.
And he'd do that, you know, that thing. It was just that snort.
90% of the times he was laughing at himself, which made it, you know, he sounded like Santa Claus sometimes.
Ironically, his reputation as a storyteller was etched as legend not over a laughing matter, but in death. August 1948, Waite Hoyt broadcasts a two-hour ad-lib eulogy on the life and times of Babe Ruth, the same day the great Bambino died.
Not 2 minutes before game, the teletype out in the newsroom started to clang, 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 and that meant there's a flash. And I went out and got it, and it said, Babe Ruth has died. And I tore it off, and I took it in, and he looked at it, and he didn't say anything, but then he came on the air, and he was shaken. He was visibly shaken. And he told the people what had happened.
He said, if you would be interested, I'm going to talk a little bit about Babe after the broadcast, so stay tuned in if you're interested.
And after the game, he got rid of the ball game, signed it off, and then he started talking about Babe Ruth.
The game was the first game of a doubleheader in Boston, and Ruth came up to the plate in the ninth inning and hit the ball over the left field fence. Now, to most baseball fans, that wouldn't mean as much to a baseball fan as it would to a baseball player. But don't forget that back in 1919, that just wasn't done. Left-handed batters knocking him over the left field fence. And he just didn't hit it over the left field fence. He hit it off a left-handed pitcher over the left field fence. And he was a left-handed batter, and the ball carried a tremendous distance. And even the White Sox, in between the games, all rushed into the clubhouse. They were trying to win the pennant, mind you. And they rushed into the clubhouse to congratulate Ruth on that particular sock.
Really, that was the first time any of us ever heard Waite do anything of that sort. He had little stories from time to time, but really nothing of any magnitude like that was.
Now, a lot of people also believe that Ruth was just a hitter. That was not so. Ruth was a pretty good man on bases. He could run the bases, but naturally he didn't have to run the bases when he had pretty good hitters coming up behind him, because those fellas coming up behind him were the types of fellas that would hit the ball into the stands. So Ruth never did steal many bases, but when he wanted to, he was an excellent base runner.
That was when he really made his mark in Cincinnati. Up until that time, he was good, he was accepted, but that was the hallmark right there.
You know, Ruth would never eat in the main dining room not because he was snooty or anything like that, but people used to bother him so much that he never could get time to eat or never get his dinner down. Of course, they do say Ping Bodie used to room with him back. He was the one that coined the expression. Ping Bodie used to room with him way back in the early 20s. Ping was quite a character himself, Ping Bodie. I don't know if you remember him or not. A little Italian fellow from the coast, a little round man, looked like a Billiken, but they were a great pair, Ruth and Bodie. And one day, somebody wanted to know whether Ping was rooming with Ruth. And Ping says, for goodness sakes, no. He said, I only room with his suitcase.
It was just a remarkable thing. It was done with such dignity and such restraint and such compassion and such depth of personal, genuine personal feeling.
Miller Huggins went to Mark Roth. He says, Mark, he said, by George, Mark was the traveling secretary. He said, by George, Mark, he said, you know, if the Babe gets out of hand again, he said, I'm going to have to fine him again. It's going to be drastic. Well, Mark says, is that so? When? He said, well, he said, now? Oh, no, Huggins says, no, I'll have to wait and see. So that night, I guess Babe overstayed the curfew again. He stayed out. We used to have a 1 o'clock rule. He stayed out after 1 o'clock, and next day out there at the clubhouse, Miller Huggins said to Mark Roth again, I guess today's the day I got to sock it to the big guy again. And Roth said, this afternoon? He said, no, I guess tonight I'll have to get after him tonight. Babe didn't get out there on time for batting practice. He showed up about a half hour late after our batting practice was over. In the ball game, he hit 2 home runs and got a couple of other hits. When I got back to the hotel after dinner, Mark Roth, the secretary, and Miller Huggins, the manager, were sitting together in the hotel lobby. Down comes the Babe in a white pants and a blue coat and a fancy-looking necktie and all dolled up. He's going out again, and Mark Roth hit Miller Huggins a punch in the ribs. He said, you gonna find him now? Now? Well, Huggins got thinking about those 2 home runs and those 4 hits. He said, I'll go on with you. He couldn't find the guy again. Well, he was a great man, a great man. And you'll never understand just how remarkable that fellow was. There'll never be another Babe Ruth, not while I live. I don't think while you live. Well, I hope it wasn't too tough for him when he went out this evening. Finally got him, didn't he?
He was a pallbearer at Babe Ruth's funeral. It was a terribly hot day, about 100 degrees and so on. And he and Joe Dugan were the pallbearers. Among the pallbearers was carrying the casket out, and there was sweating terribly. And Dugan whispered to Waite, he said, this is Waite, this is Babe Ruth's funeral. And he says to Waite, he says, I'd sure like to have a cold beer right now. Waite said, so would the Babe.
It's time for the Cincinnati Reds, brought to you by the Burger Brewing Company, brewers of the number one selling Cincinnati beer, Burger Beer. And now, here's baseball.
Well, good evening, everyone, and this is Waite Hoyt at Crosley Field.
While stories were his staple, the game was his first love, and therefore his play-by-play the priority.
One thing about Waite, he used to always, and people always pointed this out to me, why does he always say everything in the past tense?
And he hit the ball now on the ground to the third baseman, Boyer. Boyer grabbed it, made the play at first, and Chacon is out at first.
I asked him one day about that, and I said people were commenting about, he said everything in the past tense. He says, well, after all, he said, the fellow say he walked, I'd say the man had walked. Or instead of he got a base on balls or something. But he always said everything in the past tense.
If you were a baseball nut, as my dad was and as I am, you kind of read between the lines, and it was almost as if you were having a conversation with Waite Hoyt, which made him different. For a while, he had the moniker stuck on him, a dead air Hoyt.
Hart's batting right-handed, and Ellis works on him again, strike 2 as he reached out for that miss. As Hart took a shot at that, drove it into deep left center.
Well, I mean, if he's told you what's going on in the ball game, I mean, he doesn't have to tell you the sun's shining and the grass is green and the pitcher's right-hander, so he wears his glove on his left hand. He just didn't go into all that.
Eloquence was, in a certain sense, considered sissy. You know, if you used big words, that wasn't very, whatever term we used it in those days, macho.
Oh, I know whereof I speak when I say they were the nonpareils in their particular fields.
Waite taught us that you could be a real baseball fan, you could be a great baseball player, you could be smart, and you could use words that you had to occasionally look up in the dictionary.
In the 40s, as far as I can understand it, he did do it all himself, and did a lot of it off of ticker tape, which is a story that's well documented. Sitting there in the studio and waiting for the ticker tape to come through and then put the excitement or disappointment to the ball game. If you'll remember back in, what was it, 70s or early 80s, when we had the strike that Marty and myself went up in the WLW radio at the station, and they put together a game between the 27 Yankees and the 76 Reds. And all we had was just, you know, so-and-so hit a fly ball to left, so-and-so grounded to short. And so all we did was add the count to it and the pitch and the excitement. And we, the game boiled down to Waite Hoyt pitching. I can't recall who was pitching for the Reds. But anyway, Johnny Bench hit a home run off Waite Hoyt in either to tie the game or to win the game. And Gordy Coleman talked to Waite. And Waite, he says, you tell those guys that in no way that Johnny Bench would hit a home run off me to tie that game in the eighth or ninth inning. I can't remember the exact particulars. But Waite was really bent out of shape. But we said, you know, we talked to Waite later and said, that's the way the story of the game came through this computer or whatever it was. And he says, well, you tell him there's no damn way that Johnny Bench had a home run off me to win this ball game or tie it up.
As the 50s roll in, the Hoyt name was shining. On the air, he and Ruth Lyons were among the city's biggest stars. He had the bottle under control, was a major contributor to the AA program, and perhaps to keep his mind busy and hands off the bottle, he had a new passion, at which, like everything else in his life, he would excel, painting.
Well, he was ill once, and I think Ellen gave him one of those paint-by-numbers sets. And he started out, and Waite had little or no academic background in art, and I gave him a lot of my books to read on art and art history, which he read everything. He was very avid about that and did it and liked it. So eventually I said, how would you like to sit? My studio was rather large, and I said, I'll fix you up a corner, and you come over and paint when you'd like, and I'll be around to be a mentor and give you some advice.
He had many more abilities than I do. I mean, I'm good at one little tiny thing. He was good at a whole bunch of things. He was really an exceptional person.
I am positive that this is the first drawing he ever did, okay? And there, just to make sure that I can't say that that was Jimmy Durante, he put my name on the back of it.
The public Hoyt looks like a Norman Rockwell life, painter, baseball and media star, the foremost storyteller, even spinning tales that make home life seem upbeat and funny.
That Mrs. Hoyt is something, though. Ruth Lyons was doing a TV show at the time, the 50-50 Club, and the day after the season closed, Ruth wanted to know, called me up and wanted to know if I'd go on the 50-50 Club show. And I said, okay, Ruth. We hustled down there, and Mrs. Hoyt is standing off to one side, and I'm on talking to Ruth, and Ruth is congratulating the Reds and all this sort of thing, and we were having a lovely time, but you have to understand Mrs. Hoyt, she can out-talk even Ruth Lyons. And as a matter of fact, the reason that I became a radio broadcaster was because I had to talk sometime during the day, and I decided that I would better do that and be able to talk at night. So, at any rate, somebody whispered in Ruth's ear that Mrs. Hoyt was in the wings, and that had never been on TV or radio, so Ruth Lyons said, made an announcement, says, we have here today, says, for the first time in the history of her life, I guess, she says, Mrs. Waite Hoyt, who will come and visit with me, and she says that we are taking the blanket off her because she's never been on radio or TV. So they bring my wife out, and she's shaking like this, and she doesn't know what to say, and she always says the wrong thing anyway. So she's out there talking to Ruth, and Ruth is saying, she said, Mrs. Hoyt, or Ellen, if I can call you that, she said, you know, she said, I've often wondered about the wife of a baseball player or an announcer of that type. She said, just think how lonely it must be and how boring it is when he's out every night. He's away from home half the time, and then when the Reds are home, he's out at Crosley Field broadcasting. something, and you are left all by yourself. He says it must be a wearing, tearing, boring experience. And my wife says, oh, no, not at all, not at all. Says, why not? Says, I belong to the Man of the Month Club. Son, you know. My son was about 11 years old, and Dixon was still on, Paul Dixon was still on CPO with Dorothy Mack and that gang in the afternoon. And I had to do an afternoon taping or something, and I brought my son up there. I said to Dixon, I said, for God's sake, Dixon, there's one thing I don't want you to do. And by no, under any circumstance, do I want you to put Chris on the air. I went in and I had to write a show and I did it, and then finally I came out and everybody's laughing. See, gee, you should have seen your son. I said, what happened? He said, well, Dixon put him on the air. Oh, my God. So I said, well, what happens? What'd he say? What'd he do? Well, after about a half a dozen questions, Dixon says, he says, when your father does a doubleheader, and he says it's a long, tiring day, and he says he comes home, and he says he must be worn out. Isn't he worn out, Christopher, and isn't he awfully tired? Chris says, yeah, sometime, yeah, that's right, yeah. He says he comes home in that little suitcase, and he drops it in the hall, he says, but then mother takes him upstairs, and upstairs about 20 minutes, and he says they come down, and he's all right again.
But outside the spotlight, the private Hoyt household maintained a dark side that Chris Hoyt called a total mismatch.
In terms of, were we real close in those years? No, we weren't real close, no. Okay. I mean, I did my own thing, he did his own thing, but it wasn't a tight relationship. Being Waite Hoyt's son is, I mean, on the one hand, there's lots of advantages. You get to go to lots of movies and free, and you get to go to lots of ball games free. On the other hand, when you've got a guy who's a better painter than most of the ash can school in 1908, okay, all right, who's a Hall of Fame pitcher, who's the voice of the Cincinnati Reds, the most beloved man in Cincinnati, Ohio, I was never, ever going to succeed trying to emulate him or be in the shadow of my father. And whenever I was introduced in Cincinnati, it's, oh, you're Waite Hoyt's son. You know, that's bullshit, okay? I mean, I'm me, okay? Now, it took me a long time to overcome that. One of my father's strong points were also his weak points. He was very loyal, okay? I mean, and when he made up his mind to do something, nothing stopped him. And that was his second marriage to my mother. Well, he made up his mind that no matter what, he was going to succeed, okay, in his terms at this marriage. It was stupid. I mean, you couldn't get people more ill-fit for each other. I could not understand somebody of my father's stature, okay, who would put up with the crap, frankly, and there was a lot of crap. My mother was an alcoholic, a drug addict, all right? She was a hyperactive attention deficit adult. And the other thing is she f***ed around on him all the time, constantly. He had an opportunity to run for mayor in 1962, if I recall correctly, or night, and you know, he would not run. And finally, when he started to get honest about it and cut through his denial, he turned to me and he said, I can't run because of Ellen, okay? All right. And he's right, because Ellen was a loose cannon. I mean, Ellen's my mother, but absolute, total loose cannon. You're dealing with a guy that deserved better. But what used to piss me off was that one area. Okay, he couldn't get his self-esteem up, or whatever the hell it was, all right, in order to cut that cord.
And also coming up, a former World Series star, now World Series broadcaster, voice of the Cincinnati Reds, Waite Hoyt.
As a player, Hoyt had pitched in 7 World Series, but as a play-by-play man, his reputation was as a storyteller, not as a messenger of wins or championships, until 1961.
This is the top of the 6th inning here at Crosley Field in Cincinnati. The Reds have 1 run, 4 hits, no errors. The New York Yankees, no runs, 1 hit, and 1 error.
We were picked for more or less like 6th place or below that. Guys like myself, Joey Jay, who hadn't proved himself, he came over from Milwaukee, and the two of us started off. I won opening day, and I lost 6 and 7 by the All-Star break, but from that point on, I won 13 out of the last 15 ball games.
And this brings the top of the Yankee batting order up there now.
He was really fired up for that 61 series, and going back to New York made it even better.
Berkey is scraping the mound in front of the rubber. Now he's taking his signals as Edwards down, holding a low target. Richardson, the batter, stands up in front of the plate a little bit. The pitch to Richardson, he laid a ball out in left field, post, scampered in, made the catch, and Richardson is out. That sun is very bad. The outfielders are having a bit of a problem.
I was the guy pitching against Whitey Ford that made the ground ball to Kubek that threw me out. And it was 31 scoreless innings he pitched against me. So I never got a run, so you can't win without runs.
No. So Berkey ready to go. Now he pitches. There's the ball hit in out in right field, and there goes the home run for Roger Maris. His first hit of the series, and it's a home run.
The Yankees swept the Reds, and it was Waite's only postseason appearance at the microphone. He stayed with the Reds another 4 seasons.
It's Burger Baseball 65. The Cincinnati Reds with Waite Hoyt and Claude Sullivan.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. This is Waite Hoyt speaking to you from Candlestick Park in San Francisco, California, where this afternoon the Cincinnati Reds close their season with the San Francisco Giants. And this is Waite Hoyt talking to you. The Burger Brewing Company completes its 24th consecutive year as the baseball radio sponsor. Now, we of the Burger Brewing Company would like to thank you for all your patronage through all these years.
1965 was Waite's 24th and final season at the radio microphone. The Reds had a new sponsor. Burger Beer was replaced in 1966 by Wiedemann.
I know he was offered the job with Wiedemann. I'm quite sure of that.
And Waite refused it. He said, I can't sell one beer for all these years and go to another one and start selling it. He said, I can't do it.
This is Waite Hoyt about to bow out. And now as I bow out for the Burger Brewing Company, I'm not going to extend it with a lot of sort of drippy words. I just want you to know how thankful we are, how grateful we are, Berger and myself, and how personally to you, you'll all have always be in your debt. Gratitude and appreciation always, and Waite Hoyt saying goodbye. The 24 years of broadcasting is over. The 50 years association with baseball is over. And this is it, fans, and a very good afternoon and goodbye to you all. Goodbye.
Goodbye to the radio broadcast booth, but not to Cincinnati, although he did move to Florida for a while.
I began to miss the people in Cincinnati. I began to miss 4th Street and the privilege of saying hello, Joe, or Jim, or Jack, or John, or whatever it might be. The feeling remains instilled within me very, very deep that this is my town, this is my home.
In 1969, he was in Florida when word arrived he had been elected to baseball's Hall of Fame.
I came off the 18th green and someone said, you want it on the phone? So I went to the phone and they told me that it was Rick Collette of Dayton, Ohio, the sports editor of the Dayton Daily Journal up there. And he said, wait, he said, congratulations. And I said, what about? He says, well, he says, didn't you hear about it? I said, to hear about what? He says, about the Hall of Fame. I said, no, what about the Hall of Fame? He said, didn't you know that you were elected to the Hall of Fame? I said, no, I didn't know anything about it. And I didn't believe him. I said to Red, I said, look, Red, I said, no jokes, please, no gags, because this is a serious matter. And I said, I don't want anybody kidding me about this thing. He wrote, is it something I can do for you? He says, no, wait, he said, this is the truth. He said, I'll get the United Press report. So he got the Associated Press report, or whatever it was, and he read it to me in the phone. It was a traumatic effect upon me that I was almost mesmerized. I couldn't say a word. So I stood there and I said, Rita, I said, I'll call you back.
You know, he did return the call, and I was so pleased to be able to be a part of that. And when he was inducted in Cooperstown the following August, it was about as an emotional an induction as Cooperstown has ever known. It was a tremendous class. Waite Hoyt, Roy Campanella, Stan Musial, and an old-time pitcher named Stan Kovaleski. And of course, Campanella was there in the wheelchair, and the dramatic circumstances of that, and you know what kind of a talk that Hoyt is capable of making.
This is more one of the most glorious moments that a man can experience. This is the high plateau, the pinnacle of all our dreams and all our ambitions. This is the end to all of everything that was ever to be in my life. And you can't do it without the little privacies, the little intimate conversations, the little encouragement, and the great understanding of the girl you're married to. I don't know why I fill up when I think of her, you know. I must tell you a story about Mrs. Hoyt, if I may. She has never been over familiar with baseball. That is to say, she can't talk baseball like some of the ladies of the game can. So when I was notified that I was in the Hall of Fame, I was on the golf course. And I hurried over to the cottages in which we were living in Florida to leave word that, to leave word with her that I had made the Hall of Fame. And she wasn't home, she was at the beach, and I left word for someone to tell her that I was in the Hall of Fame. The message was imparted, and whereupon she immediately ran around to all her girlfriends and said, "What do you think? What do you think? Waite's in the House of Fame." But I know one of the real great thrills of the day is to have her with me and my son, Christopher. Where are you, Chris? Here he is. He's ready to take pictures. So when you have your families with you and you experience something like this, it does something inside and creates a tremendous emotion, which is difficult to live down.
And so 31 years after his retirement as a player, Waite Hoyt's plaque hung in Cooperstown. But immortality did not mean perfection. Ellen Hoyt was an ill woman. Her memory was failing her. By the 70s, she was living at a senior citizen home and receiving 24-hour assisted living.
Actually, I think she burned her brains out on speed and booze, okay? Alzheimer's, I mean, there's no Alzheimer's been in our family ever, except for her.
Ellen Hoyt never lived with or recognized her husband again. She died at the senior citizen's home in 1982.
Ellen was a great lady. She was witty. She was very nice. I thought she was a beautiful woman, statuesque.
Waite had actually known Betty Deary since the 1940s. She was a fan, then a friend, then she became his third wife.
He said he had talked with Ellen Levy in Chicago. That was his niece who lives in Chicago. And she said, "I can always tell when it's Monday because you're in a bad mood." And he said, "What do you mean?" And she said, "Well, you see a lot of Betty over the Saturdays, and you see a lot of Betty on Sundays, and then on Monday you're always just sort of low." And I could tell it was Monday. And I don't know why. "Why don't you two get married?" And he said, "That's a hell of a good idea." And he said, and then he called and proposed over the phone.
Betty was brought up in the sport, and she's just as interesting to speak with. And Betty was just that type of a nurturing, caring, loving person that a man needs in his declining years. She put spark in Waite's life.
Well, we were in Florida in Tampa for spring training one year. We used to go every year with Ruby Wright and Barney Rapp down to there. And we had been to one of the dinners that they had, all of us, and Waite and Betty had sat next to Regine and me. And Waite said, "I'd like to go see a movie. You know this town pretty well, Bob?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, let's go see a movie." So I said, "Okay." I looked at my watch and it was 9:45, and usually the box office closes at 10. The only movie open in Tampa at that hour was all the way across town, out Dale Maybury and way out that area to a shopping mall. We got there about 5 or 10 minutes after 10. The booth was closed, and I went around the back of the booth and I said, "Could we get in? We don't care if we miss the first part of the movie." And he said, "Well, there's only one movie that is not about over, and that's 48 hours. I hadn't heard anything about it. I knew what it was all about. So 48 hours sounds like a news show on ABC or something. So when I think of this, it makes me laugh just to chuckle. Because when we got into the movie, we sat down there, and it started to unfold what the story was about.
This is with Eddie Murphy.
With Eddie Murphy.
And every other word was a curse word, and not just a garden variety like darn or heck or shucks or whatever. I'm talking about some heavy duty ones. And I hear Waite going, ah, ha, 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 with that laugh of his. And so I was embarrassed because I had never met Betty before. That was the first time I met Betty. And I was embarrassed because I was with her and Ray Jean, and there they are with this terrible language in the film. So the next morning I saw Waite and Betty having breakfast in the dining room at the hotel. And I walked over and I said, I want to apologize for that movie last night. Waite said, apologize? That was wonderful. I really enjoyed that. And Betty said, Bob, when I was secretary to the National League, I used to have to make a list out that would get you immediately thrown out of a ballgame if you said that to an umpire in an argument. And I learned five new words.
At age 83, Waite Hoyt was married for the third time, a personality in more demand than ever. He still had one more relationship to mend. He and son Chris would share the dais during the last public appearance Waite Hoyt would ever make, June 1984, in Covington, Kentucky.
It was a remembrance breakfast. I think it was a tri-state AA meeting.
Thank you, Daddy. How do you follow an act like that? Okay. I have to tell you, I've had a lot of experiences in my life, and I'm not going to bore you with most of them. But today is probably one of the best days I've ever had. And I say that because I never believed I'd be up here talking with my father. So my father and I really had sort of a rocky relationship for 20 years, okay? And, I mean, there were certain years that he didn't even know where I was, all right? And on my fourth step, I think I wrote 20 pages about my father, okay? And I have to tell you, all I feel for him today is admiration and love. Thank you.
I didn't really understand that until the last year he was alive. Fortunately, that year, okay, was made up for a lifetime of pain, okay? That was a great year. And that talk in June was terrific. I mean, that was a great year.
Waite Hoyt died Saturday, August the 25th, 1984, at 7 a.m. in Jewish Hospital of a heart attack, 15 days short of his 85th birthday. The schoolboy from Brooklyn had led an adventurous life filled with grim complication and rare accomplishment. It did not rain on the day of his funeral. After all, the voice that would have filled such a delay had been silenced, although not for eternity.
There isn't a day that I'm not confronted by somebody that talks about him, or, I mean, I don't bring it up, they do. They'll bring something up and they want to talk about it. I meet people, strangers. Somebody will say, that's Mrs. Waite Hoyt, and somebody comes over to my table in the restaurant and starts, you know, said, may I sit down? I want to talk to you a little bit. And this goes on and on. And so I never feel that Waite is dead.
The manager of the Yankees, whose name is Miller Huggins, and who happens to be buried in Spring Grove, a quarter of a mile from where I will find eternal rest. Every time I go out and see my own grave out there, which is there, and past Miller Huggins, I hear a That's Miller whirring around in the grave because they...
Other people, when they die, they're dead. With Waite, that's not so. He lives.
Ha, ha, ha.